Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let those who are glad to be amongst the redeemed say amen.
Amen.
Our God has saw fit to allow us another opportunity to be able to gather and study another portion of his word, and for that and that alone, we ought to be grateful. Amen?
Amen.
It is good to be with you all on this evening. My wife had to tend to her responsibilities and teach tonight, so that is why she's not here. She is one of the teachers there at 6th Street, so her and Layla are there. But nonetheless, the message will be the same. Amen? Amen. That means I don't have her eye to let me know when I'm running over, so I may run a little long, but I won't do that. I won't do that because I want us all to be here tomorrow, and I want to encourage everyone. I usually do this on the first day I do a gospel meeting, is encourage each one to try and bring one guest throughout the week. Since I didn't express that on Sunday and I express it tonight, do it for tomorrow. Let's close out tomorrow with a packed house because the sermon will be appropriate for anyone who does not know about the Lord's church. And for those who know about the church but have forgotten the identity of the Lord's church. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Matthew, the chapter is 27. Matthew, the chapter is 27, and we'll begin at verse number 32. When you have it, say amen. Matthew, the chapter is 27, and we'll begin at verse number 32, where we will draw our thought from this evening, reading down through verse number 40. Again, just to recap, our overall theme is, what's the meaning of? Sunday morning, we opened with the stones. Sunday afternoon, the meaning of the blood. On Monday evening, the meaning of the measurements. On last evening, the meaning of the hedge. This evening, I want to deal with what is the meaning of the cross in the middle. What is the meaning of the cross in the middle? Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 32, and the Bible reads, "And as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they were come unto a place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, 'They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots.' And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up over his head his accusation written, 'This is Jesus, the King of the Jews.' Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, 'Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross.'" What is the meaning of the cross in the middle? We see in verse number 38, there was a thief crucified on his left and one crucified on his right. So we have to understand there's something different about the cross that was in the middle. This evening, I want us to deal with the meaning and purpose of the cross and Christ, his death on the cross, but more importantly, the significance of the cross in the middle. The cross itself, if you will, was an instrument framed from wood with intersecting pieces, with the longer section running lateral and the shorter section running up horizontal. With an oriental origin, it was later practiced and adopted by the Romans as their chief method of punishment for criminals. It was essentially used as a method of torture and deterrent. But in Christ's case, it was used as a means of showing the punishment for any and all who denounced Caesar and the Roman Empire's policies. It was a death, my friends, that only Christ could die for his church and for his people. Though spiritual, he felt the pain, as we see him state in Matthew chapter 27 and verse number 46. The Bible says, "Jesus cried out with a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?'" But he understood his role, as he earlier acknowledged over in Matthew chapter 26 and the verses 39. Jesus said, "Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." Same breath. "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine will be done." He understood his role, my friends. That's because Jesus came up with the purpose. So many today don't understand that Jesus wasn't just some Johnny come lately. He came up with the purpose. The Bible tells us over in Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9 and the verse is 56. Jesus himself said, "For the Son of Man has not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." Jesus came that all of us might be able to obtain salvation. Luke chapter 19 and the verses 10. Luke 19 and the verses 10. Jesus stated again, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what? That which was lost." Contrary to popular belief, my friends, all of us were lost. Until we met and developed a relationship with Christ Jesus, all of us were lost. Not only did he come with a purpose, but Jesus came on a mission. You know, sometimes we need to recognize when people are on a mission, they're going to make sure they get what they are after. I've been picking on Brother Carrison enough. I'm certain when Brother Richardson saw Sister Richardson before she became Sister Richardson, he was on a mission. He was going to make sure he changed her last name. I'm quite certain when Brother Brown was pursuing Sister Brown, that Brother Brown, not this one. When he was pursuing Sister Brown, he was on a mission to make sure the job was accomplished. My friends, understand and know that Jesus was on a mission from his Father. Turn your Bibles over to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2 and the verse is 49. Luke chapter 2 and the verse is 49. Jesus speaking to his mom, he says, "And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wished ye not that I must be about what? My Father's business." Jesus came here with a purpose in mind. He came here to do what his daddy told him to do. Not only that, but Jesus came to tear down. Some don't recognize that my Lord was in the construction business before construction even got a boom. Jesus was in the construction business. What do you mean, Brother Brown? Construction companies know how to tear things down, don't they? Jesus came to tear some things down. Brother Brown, you making it up? Well, if that's what you think, turn your Bibles to Ephesians. Ephesians, the chapter is 2, and we'll start around verse number 13. Ephesians chapter 2 and beginning at verse number 13. Bible says, "But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh how? By the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one and hath done what? Broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you who were far off and to them that were nigh." Bible says, "For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father." Thank God Jesus came to tear down in order to build up. Whenever you get ready to get your house built, my friends, you want to make sure they survey the land where your house is going to go. You want to make sure your house is not on a sinkhole. Amen. You want to make sure there's a solid foundation for them to build your house on. We know how to apply that physically, and we need to do the same thing spiritually. We need to make sure we are building up on a solid foundation, one that cannot be moved, one that cannot be shaken by the courses of time, but one that's going to stand the test of time. And I put forward to you, we have that in Christ Jesus. My friends, not only did he come to tear down, but Jesus came to build. He came to build his own church. Look what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and the verse is 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and the verse is 10. Bible says, "According to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise what? Master builder." Jesus said, "I have laid the Bible says, Paul is speaking, "I have laid the foundation and another buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon." Why, Brother Paul? For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is who? Jesus Christ. You can't go out here and build your own church. I recognize that some people try and do that. You know, sometimes when you go in these sectarian churches and they tell you, well, our pastor says this and whatever he says goes, you can't get mad at them. That's that man's church. Amen. He's the founder of it. All of that belongs to him. I'm not trying to tear nothing down they got. I want them to understand they're standing on sinking sand. Amen. And the last time I checked, sinking sand is going to take you down. It may go fast, it may go slow, but eventually you're going to go down if you don't grab a hold up to a lifeline. No, my friends, Jesus came to build. Matthew chapter 16 and the verses 18. Jesus said unto Peter, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'm going to build my church. He didn't say churches. He didn't say multiple churches. He told Peter he was going to build his church upon the solid foundation that he was Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. My friends, understand this, that Jesus' death on the cross was one that only he could die. You or I could not have died on the cross for men's sins. Amen. If we would have died on the cross, mankind still would have been lost. Amen. You would have just been a sacrificial lamb hanging up on that cross. So, and you got some crazy folk out there that'll do that today. I'm dying for my religion. You don't need to die. Amen. No, unless because of your religion you are killed, but you don't need to die to establish your own religion. No. And we need to understand, my friends, in the Lord's church today, we need to understand the proper application of Revelation 2:10. I usually close my sermons with that, but I want to take this moment to understand when the Bible says, be thou faithful until death. That's not saying until you die. That's helping you understand that your faithfulness may cause somebody to have to kill you because you are a Christian. And too many times we get comfortable here in America. Amen. No, we need to recognize, we need to always let folk know what we're all about. Too many times we bow down and cow down to anything and everything. That ought not be. If folk have the audacity to tell you about their church, you need to tell them about the church, the one and only church by which you can make heaven your everlasting and eternal home. But not only that, my friends, know that Jesus spoke of his death in advance. He spoke of his death, even though some wanted to stop it. They had to realize it was of God. And I don't care how much power you got, you can't stop God. Amen. On our best day, we can't stop God. Look what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16 and the verse is 21. Matthew 16 and the verse is 21. Bible says, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those things that be of men. Understand, my friends, this is that same Peter. This is the same Peter that denied my Lord three times. Amen. No, isn't it interesting how we as members of the Lord's church can one day be on fire and the next day be cold as ice? Amen. No. When's the last time you invited somebody out to church? You don't need to answer that question, but think on it. Amen. No. I want you to know right now, if Big Mama was having a birthday party, you're going to call everybody Big Mama no. Amen. Everybody got a Big Mama. That's why I say Big Mama. Everybody know about Big Mama. Everybody got a Big Mama in their family. You need to understand that when it comes down to our worship, you need to call everybody you know and let them know Big Daddy is having a party. Right. Amen. No, his name is Jesus Christ. Now, don't belittle his name, but our Lord is having an opportunity for you to worship with him every first day of the week. And that is a celebratory occasion for us in the Church of Christ. Amen. Now, the world is getting excited about December 25th. Jesus wasn't born in no December. Amen. Now, if people would just use that much of their brain to do some homework, they'd realize it was a Catholic priest that set December 25th as the day of Christ's birth because they were tired of the world celebrating it so many different days out of the year. Who died and made them God? Amen. Now, and sometimes we fall right in line with them. Amen, Walls. What you doing with that? Oh, it's Christ's birthday, child. I'm getting me some Christmas presents. Stop telling that lie. Amen. No, we don't know when Christ was born, but I can guarantee tell you this, it was not in December. You run over there to that part of the world in December and see who out there in the middle of a field. Ain't nobody out there. So that lets you know right there by proof that it was not December. So let's go back to the book. He says to worship him in spirit and in truth every first day of the week. Friends, we need to understand and take that to heart, that we as Christians are the only ones people can look to find out what thus says the Lord. Our Lord became weak concerning his death and had to be comforted because others were not around. How many times do you look for a dear family friend or a loved one and they're not around? You're going through some of the darkest days of your life, and the ones that say, I love you, are not there to comfort you. Understand, you're not going through anything my Lord didn't go through. Jesus said, could you not wait just an hour? Just 1 hour while I went off and prayed? Y'all looking at me strange. Let me show you that in the Bible. Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. I want you to put your eyeballs on it. Amen. No, Luke 22 and the verse is 43. Luke 22 and the verses 43 and verse 44. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. Bible says, and being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat were as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Bible says that Jesus was there, my friends, weeping in pain, recognizing what he had to face. And where were his disciples? Where were his apostles? I'm not sure if you can relate, but I'm quite certain, Brother Harrison and Brother Richardson, in your lifetimes, you've had those moments where you wanted some brothers to be around, but just like a light and roaches, when the light came on, they scattered away, and you were standing there by yourself. But even in those points of time, I have realized I'd rather be standing alone with God by my side than with a million men strong on either side of me. Because with God, all things are possible. My friends, understand that Jesus died the death that only he could die. Amen. For when others were crucified, the soldiers would break their legs to add a little bit more pain and speed up the death, if you will. But when it came to Jesus, when the soldiers came up to break his legs, they recognized he was already dead. So they didn't have to break his legs, not realizing they were fulfilling a prophecy of the Old Testament, which told us not a bone shall be broken. So to make sure he was dead, they pierced him in the side. Out with came blood and water. Brother Brown, what's the significance? At the point of death, your blood separates from your water, and it's two identical items that come out of your body. While you're living, it's all intermingled in together. But when you die, I believe the term is collate or something like that, or coagulate. Some of y'all scientific people know what I'm talking about. It separates at the point of death, and when they pierced him in the side, out with came blood and water to give them the indication that Jesus was dead. But thanks be to God, he didn't stay right there, my friends. He got up with all power in his hands. My friends, when you understand the meaning of the cross, when you know that it was Jesus who died on the cross, I want you to gather the concepts of understanding and knowing there's some significance to the cross in the middle. Turn with me, if you will, to Hebrews, the chapter is 9. Hebrews, the chapter is 9, and the verse is 14. Hebrews chapter 9 and the verse is 14. Understand, the dictionary says middle is the point between two given points or times. I want you to understand, my Lord stood between two worlds, killing off the old and bringing in the new. He had to die die in order for us to live. Some say, Brother Brown, if I was there, they wouldn't have been able to kill Jesus. I want you to know you didn't have to worry about the Roman soldiers. I would have moved you out of the way myself. My Lord had to die in order for us to live. Sometimes folk don't understand, if Jesus didn't die, that means the old law would still be in effect. And the last time I checked, ain't none of y'all in here Jewish or former Jews. Sammy Davis Jr. been dead. Amen? Hey, you got to realize ain't none of y'all Jews. Jesus had to die in order for us to live. Look what the Bible says in Hebrews 9, beginning at verse number 14. Hebrews 9 and the verses 14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a testament is, there must of necessity be the death of a testator, for a testament is a force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Thank God Jesus died on Calvary's cross. Thank God those soldiers pierced him in the side. Thank God Pilate had him put to death so that you and I could have a chance at everlasting life. He didn't die on that cross on the left. He didn't die on the cross on the right. Thanks be to God, he died on that cross up that was in the middle. I want you to understand there is some power in the cross that was in the middle. The cross on the left, if you will, represented the years of fighting and turmoil before Christ came on the scene. The cross on the right represents the fighting and turmoil still going on today. But the cross, my Lord, in the middle said, I am peace that passeth all understanding. The cross on the left stands for all those who are locked up mentally to the forces of darkness. The cross on the right stands for those who are locked up physically. But the cross, my Lord, in the middle said, if I make you free, you are free indeed. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad about the cross in the middle. The cross on the left represents those who get high by ecstasy, cocaine and marijuana. The cross on the left represents those who get buzzed by drinking alcohol, fine wines, and spirits. But the cross in the middle said he would lift us up by the Spirit that lives within. I don't know about you, but I thank God I don't need no mad dog to get happy. Amen. I thank God I don't need no, what's that stuff called? Cognac? What's it called? See, I knew somebody would know that. Cognac. I thank God. I'm messing with you, Brother Brown. I thank God I don't need that to get high. We got to realize we get high on Jesus Christ. The cross on the left stands for the debt we've already accrued. The cross on the right stands for the bills we have and don't even know about. But the cross in the middle said that he became poor so that we, through him, might become rich. I don't know about you, but I'm appreciative to the cross in the middle. The cross on the left represents the trouble that I've made it through. The cross on the right represents the trouble I'm getting ready to go to or already going through. But the cross in the middle told me a long time ago, trouble don't last always. He said, weeping may endure for the night, but joy, sweet joy, is going to come in the morning. Thank God there is the morning. The night may be long, but thank God when the sun begins to shine. Thank God the sun got up out of that old borrowed tomb. He folded up the clothes nice and neat. Thank God he didn't stay buried there. My friends, the cross on the left represents the circles that will run around in this life. The cross on the right represents the dead ends we may have come to. But the cross pops up in the middle. Said, I am the way of the truth and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. The cross on the left represents the deaths we have all suffered with. The cross on the right represents the many deaths that are still to come. But the cross in the middle said, right, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord, for they do rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. I don't know about you, but I am glad to be a member of the Lord's church. I am glad to be able to identify with the cross in the middle. The cross on the left stands for those who think too little of themselves and their abilities. The cross on the right stands for those who think they are more than what they are. But the cross in the middle told me a long time ago, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. You can tell me what you don't think I can do, but through my God, I know I'm able to do whatever He wants me to do. You can say what you want to say, but I'll go with Jesus any day of the week. The cross on the left represents the thousands of false religions throughout America. The cross on the right represents the millions of false religions in the world today. But the cross in the middle represents His own, the only one you can read about from what thus says the Lord. The churches of Christ still are the only ones that salute you. Baptists won't do, Methodist won't do, Catholic won't do, whatever it is, just won't do. Why? Because you can't take from the Word of God and try and establish your own religion. If you take one, you gotta take the whole thing. My friends, because of the cross in the middle, I have life and I have it more abundantly. You need to understand, some folk are always allowing their trials to get them down. No, my friends, you ain't going through nothing and everybody else ain't going through. You ain't the only one's got problems. Amen. Brother Brown, you just don't understand. I got bills coming everywhere. Me too. They go on the counter when they come in. And when I got some money, I'll pay them. Otherwise, they just going to sit right there. Yeah, amen. No, I'm not going to let them bill collectors steal my joy. Amen. No, I made the bill and I'll pay it when I can. Amen. I'm going to take my responsibility. Yeah. Some of us go crying every time we get the bill. And if God made a way last month, don't you know He's going to make a way this month? Amen. You know, sometimes I get mad at those moms that get government assistance. When I worked over in Daytona, we worked in social services. And they used to come in there trying to get rent assistance, Brother Carrison. And some people say, well, Brother Brown, that's okay. Everybody can't make it. Now, this is what got me. They only had to pay $10 a month. Y'all sure enough got quiet. Because when they came into the office to sit down with me, that old sorry behind joker that's selling that stuff on the side to get the money that you're not reporting. I know we ain't got no ladies here that know about that. That's selling those illegal substances. You telling me that sorry behind joker can give you $10 to pay your rent? And you cooking him something to eat and not your kids? You see, they didn't like seeing Mr. Brown, because Mr. Brown always had a sermon for him. Amen. It was Volusia County's money, but I had to give him a little something to go along with it. You need to understand our young ladies need to take some value in themselves. You don't need something that's going to drag you down. Amen. And our young men need to keep their heads up high. Amen. Every skirt that swings in front of you ain't for you. Amen. Because once she got you, that's it. Amen. She going to make sure you give her a baby. Amen. Our young men get good jobs, and next thing you know, they don't got them one of them, I think they call them gold diggers or something like that. That's what they're going to get them one of them, and that's not going to happen with young men I know. Amen. You need to keep your eyes on women in the church, and she need to keep her eyes on men in the church. And don't stop just there, because you got some sorry ones in the church. Amen. Amen. You need to get to know them to make sure they are what it's all about. Let me move on with the lesson, my friends. Because of the cross, because of the cross in the middle, I'm not worried anymore. Amen. America's on a highway to hell, and I'm still not worried anymore because my faith is in Christ Jesus. So, my friends, I'm not worried about where this country is going. I'm not worried about this world. My concern are those souls who don't know Jesus Christ. I want to teach them that there is a better option. No, amen. No, while the rains may be pouring, I want to tell them about a land where the sun shines every day. I want them to know that this is not it. This is just the beginning. We ain't got nothing on eternity. Yeah, you could live 150 years here. Can you imagine that? Being 150 years old and that still ain't nothing in comparison to eternity. Yeah, my friends, because of the cross in the middle, I'm not worried. Because of the cross in the middle, I can face tomorrow and all my fears are gone. Amen. No, I don't care what you say about me. I don't care what you try and do to me. Yeah, you know, sometimes people say, Rico, you know, we're preaching like that. Somebody gonna kill you, and what's that gonna do for me? Amen. No, you kill me, all you're going to do is speed up my reward. I make sure when I lay down at night and when I get up in the morning, I'm all right with God. Amen. No. Oh, I'm going to miss my daughter and my wife and my brothers and sisters, but guess what? I'm going on to my reward. No, you just sped it up for me. That's all. Amen. And that's one thing we need to face as a reality in the Lord's church. Some of us try and live like we ain't going to die. Amen. No, it is appointed unto all of us to die. And after this, the judgment. But the most important question is, how are you going to die? Right with God or not right with Him? My friends, because of the cross in the middle, I recognize some of y'all got nicknames. Amen. Brother Kerrison's nickname is Honey Bun. Y'all ain't know that, did you? That's his nickname, Honey Bun. No. Brother Brown's nickname may be Mr. Nitro. Us Knights understand what that is. That's the mascot for UCF. Brother Richardson's nickname may be Air Sergeant. You know, whatever Sister Richardson want to call him. And Byron, I don't know what your nickname may be, but we got to understand all of us got some nicknames. And you want people to call you by your nickname. But I want you to know one day I'm looking forward to my Lord to say servant. Amen. No, you better not ever call me a slave. I'm looking forward to the day He says to me, servant, well done. No, thou hast been faithful over a few things in the end. No, and I'll make you ruler over many. My friends, there are a lot of things we don't want to be called, but that's something you ought to look forward to being called one day. A servant by the Most High God. You know, I'm reminded, Paul said, I've lost my home over in Tarsus, but I have kept the faith. My friends, along the course of this life, you may lose some friends, but hold on to your faith. You may lose a job or two because of your religion, but hold on to your faith. When all is said and done, that's the only thing you're going to have on Judgment Day, is your faith. And because of the cross in the middle, our faith is assured. Amen. Our faith is hell proof, and our faith makes us to be heaven bound. All right. My friends, we don't have to worry about defending our religion because it changes every year. No, sir, no, ma'am. There is no general council to meet and make a decision. You know, some years ago, the Mormons had a meeting. And the Mormons decided that they had to relook at the thing, and based on their understanding, there were going to be some blacks in heaven. Can you imagine that? They had a revelation that contrary to what Joseph Smith had said, there were actually going to be some blacks in heaven. Now, some would say it's about time. Let me help y'all understand how they got that revelation. It's called the IRS. Amen. When they came knocking at the door, telling them that they had to start allowing other races inside the Mormon religion, that's when they had a revelation. How about that? The IRS helped them have a revelation. But I want you to know the GOD gonna help all of us have a revelation one day. It's going to be revealed what you have done whilst you're in this body. My friends, if you have not served God with your utmost, why not start tonight? Why not walk out if you're rededicating your life to God, saying, Lord, here am I, send me. Whatever you want me to do, I'm going to do. I recognize it's not going to be easy. I recognize that you never said the road would be easy, but Father, you said you would make it easier. My friends, we have the assurity that Jesus said, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Sometimes family forsakes us. Sometimes family will leave you high and dry. Amen. Don't have something your family members want to borrow when they want to borrow it. Amen. And then you try and call on them for something you know they have, but you didn't have what they wanted to borrow from you when they wanted it. I guarantee you they're not going to pick up the phone. But my friends, you can call Jesus on the main line anytime you want and tell him what you want. And when he is ready, he'll answer your call. And it's nothing like knowing you don't have to wait. Amen. You don't have to wait for a signal that says, well, all lines are busy, please hold. Amen. My Lord has the opportunity to hear all of our prayers. If you're present this evening and you're not a member of this church, of the Church of Christ, I ask you, why not? Why aren't you a member of the only church you can read about in what thus says the Lord? The Bible helps us to understand we are added to the body of Christ. You're not voted in, my friends. You are added to the body of Christ by hearing his word. Romans chapter 10 and the verses 17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You must believe that which you have heard, as Crispus in his house did in Acts chapter 18 and the verses 8. Upon that belief, you must say, Lord, no longer my will, but thy will be done. It's called repentance. Acts chapter 2 and the verses 38. Upon that change of heart, you must confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Romans chapter 10 and the verses 10. Upon that confession, you are then eligible to go down in the watery grave of baptism for the remission of your sins. 1 Peter chapter 3 and the verses 21, arising to live your life faithfully until death. If you're present this evening, you're a member of the Lord's church, and you recognize you have not been living your life like you know about the cross in the middle, why not walk out of here making sure you're right with God? Don't worry about what mankind's going to say. My friends, man going to talk about you whether you're doing good or bad. But make sure you're living and doing right according to God. If you stand subject to the Savior's invitation, why don't you come forward as together we stand and sing.